Hey there. Is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible, because it's the divinely inspired Word of God, and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate, and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Service right here on the Solid Word. We're the Reverend Roger Paul. You're live with us here at the Solid Word International Ministries, live on Facebook as we are 11 o'clock Atlantic Standard Time every morning. Well, we're a bit late this morning, but we're giving God thanks for His mercies. We're giving God thanks for His goodness, and we thank you for being with us here at this time. Hey, let us know where you're watching us. Let us know from where you're watching, whether you're here in Barbados, across the region, or any country around the world, okay? There are 196 countries. We'd love to be able to reach every single country in the world, but you know what? We'd love to more so be where God would have us to be. So we're grateful to you today for being here. My goodness, it is the second to last Sunday of the year 2020. Can you believe it? The second to last Sunday of the year 2022. My goodness. Week after next week, we'll be wishing you Happy New Year. Believe it. All right, well, I'm Krista J. Paul, and as you see in the description, today we'll be hearing about God Chose Me, based on Luke chapter 2, and I'm looking forward to hearing what the Word of God has to say to us through His manservant, Reverend Roger Paul, this morning. Well, there was one who was chosen, and it's Jesus Christ, and He came as a babe, lying in lowly estate, so that He can be born as a man to die, so that we can be saved. I know that this song is a familiar song to you. Sing along with me. It's a classic, classic one. What child is this? What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap in sleeping, who angels greet with anthem sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping?
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much this morning for that beautiful song. I always love that song. You know, when it comes to Christmas, boy, I truly love this time of year. I am not shocked or surprised by what is going on in the world today. More and more are moving away from Christmas. Even Christians today are finding reasons why they should not celebrate the birth of God's Son. And they believe more the words of a scholar or of someone else than they believe the word of God. But the Bible shows us that, just briefly here, the Bible shows us that God celebrated his Son. And he encouraged others to celebrate the birth of his Son. Now again, this year, I want to emphasize this because I don't want us to get misled. I don't want to mislead anyone. But we do not know the exact date of the birth of God's Son. Some said that the emperor back then had chosen the 25th to cancel out the pagan worship. All those are theories and things people hold to. We don't know the date, exact date, but here's what we know. He was born. Amen?
Amen.
He was born. And praise God. I'm thankful for those who chose to celebrate that birth. God tells us to do that. And the date of the 25th of December has been chosen. A lot of things celebrate on that day. We don't celebrate those things. We celebrate his birth. Think of this. When were you born? I was born the 10th of April, 1972. Were other things done on that day? Of course they were done on that day. Before I was born? Of course before I was born. Would that stop me from having my birthday on that day? No, it wouldn't. You know? And so, people find all kind of reasons why they shouldn't celebrate Christmas. My friend, this morning, it's a time of celebration. You know, not as the world celebrates. I want to remind you of that. As the world celebrates, all the buying and selling and merchandising and gifts giving and all these kind of things. So we do those things, you know, we eat and so on and so forth, but that's not the reason. Even the song we have for Christmas, celebrate him this Christmas. You know, you can go on YouTube, you can find that song there, a song by my wife and my daughter. It says there's a cause, and it's not Santa Claus, okay? And so we celebrate in the right way, my friend, this morning. Amen? We celebrate in the right way. And so, bless God for this time of year. You know, next week, this time, is the day we celebrate Christmas. We invite you next week for our 5 o'clock Sunday morning service. Okay, Christmas morning. I always love that. I love the idea of just waking up and getting to church very early and coming out when the sun is coming up. And it's just a beautiful time we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. So join us next Sunday morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, our early morning Christmas service. We're so thankful. Thankful for you this morning who have been a part of this ministry for this past 3 years. Okay, we thank God for you. Thank God for raising up this ministry and to be a blessing to many, many this morning. You know, here's the truth. Here's the truth. If there were only one of you that would be reached through this ministry, oh, that would be a blessing. That would be a blessing. Because the Bible tells us that one soul is more important than this entire world. And so we thank God for the many of you who write into us and we have discussions with thank God for the blessing of the Solid Word International Ministries. Amen. Please remember to continue praying for our book series. And again, we want to direct your attention to the Solid Word BookSeries.com. That is our website for our books. You can go there. You can find our children's books there. And very wonderful gifts for children. We want to encourage you again. We want to encourage you again to go down and sell Christmas books. And you can buy, download it from right away. That's the gift wrap it, none of that. Download it from the Solid Word BookSeries.com. And there it is. Your children may have it. Your Sunday school children may have it. It's far cheaper there to get it. You don't have to wrap it and wait it in and so on. And for you Sunday school teachers, good, great gifts for your children. There's a gift for Bobby for Christmas. There's all the Christmas books there, and you can go and find them. Or you can find also some of the books we have there for children. It makes great gift. And children today have their laptops and they have their tablets and so on. They can download it easily. And you can get the books right there at the SolidWordBookSeries.com. Please do that for us. And we want to write some nice, good material for children, that they may enjoy it and enjoy the rich word of God, okay? You know, to be a part of their lives. You know, I want to tell you this, that when I was a young boy, that was not too long ago, you know, I loved books that were vivid in color or imagery and good reading captures my attention. And I can tell you the Lord has given us the ability to do such, in which we can share with others and capture their imagination, capture what they're yet thinking. You know, you can go to our books, to our books, so you can find these books here. A gift for Bob for Christmas. You can find, go ahead. You can find, I hope you can see it there. The True Christmas Story and so on there for your children there. And I'm telling you, my friend, good material, okay? Thank you for doing that, my friend. And then, of course, you can go to my wife's website, find our songs there, Christmas songs and so on that can be a blessing for you. And books she has there for your help and blessings, Nuggets for Christmas, 7 Nuggets for Christmas, and so on, okay? You can go to ChristaJPaul.com, ChristaJPaul.com, and find it all there, okay? God bless you. Thank you so much for being a part of this ministry, for praying for this ministry, and for sharing it. Many of you share this ministry every weekend. Thank you so much for helping us be a part of the homes of many, okay? If you have your Bible this morning, I want to share with you a simple message, a very simple message this morning, entitled, God Chose Me. God Chose Me. When you think of the Christmas season, when you think of how important it is, especially in the face of eternity, you think of how God sent his only begotten Son that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Think also the fact that God have chosen you and I to share this message. It did not come, the message did not come for the elite. It did not came to the elite. It is not to be shared only by the elite. Oh, but God has chosen me. God has chosen you to do this magnificent work and spread the word of God. Would you join me this morning as we look in our scripture to the book of Luke in chapter 2, reading from verse 8 of Luke, chapter 2, verse 8 through 20. The Bible reads, "They were in the same country, shepherds abiding in the field, keeping their flock, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them. They were afraid, sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in a manger. Suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even to Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord had made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph, the babe laying in a manger, lying in a manger. When they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. Oh, Father in heaven, I pray, oh God, this morning you'll take control of this service. Give liberty, oh God, to my lips to speak only what you would have me speak, Lord God, or what your spirit will want us to hear this morning, even me, your servant, Lord God. Take control, oh Father God. And those in our midst, oh God, today will know that it is indeed a privilege to be chosen by the Lord God of heaven to proclaim this wonderful, this beautiful good news. The world may hear and be saved. Bless us, oh God, today. Speak to us only as you can. We praise you and give you thanks for the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we celebrate this year. We bless you, Lord God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. What a wonderful time of year. Time you may think that if man had control of doing this, or there would be a lot of pomp and pageantry. There would be a lot of lights and glimmer and flashes and well-dressed and groomed persons attending this event. Oh, they'll want to choose the biggest arena, most decorations, best of everything. Because coming into this event is no one other but the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, but the Prince of Peace. Boy, we know he deserves the best. But God had control of this. And God decided to decorate the scene, invite the guests to this wonderful event. Oh, it was indeed the most important event in mankind's history. It's not landing on the moon, not going to the depth of the sea in a craft made by man's hands. It's not, my friend, this morning, celebrating the greatest riches. Oh, God had his way in this event, my friend, this morning. He chose, my friend, to invite the meanest of persons. The meanest of persons in this event. Can you think of this morning, my friend? Why would God choose you? Why would God choose me? There's nothing good. You know, there's nothing good about me that I would think would cause your mighty God to want to choose me. Yet he did. He didn't choose me for some other reason, or today I think Christians are losing this fact. We're not here to look good or to get the world's riches and look all this mighty. Matter of fact, we are chosen to spread his message, to spread his way, to show his love. We're not seeing that a lot today. Matter of fact, the reason I'm saying that, I don't want to blast Christians like that, you know, just because they're doing bad things, but because we are supposed to be doing these good things. Even the Apostle Paul in Corinthians told the Christians, hey, awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the gospel of God. I speak this to your shame. And the Apostle Paul talks to Christians in such a blunt way. We are called to be different in this world today. Bless others and to be a blessing to others. And so, God this morning, my friend, he chose the shepherd. What do you think it is this morning, my friend? God chose the humble estate of these shepherds. After 400 years of talking to men, of visiting men, we're not told that God had done any kind of visitation to men in this 400-year period between Malachi and Matthew. And the first time he is going to openly talk to men like this, he's going to communicate to man, he chose or he selected folks who no one else would want to select. He chose, my friend, he selected folks to do this great job that no one else would want. We're told because of the proximity to Jerusalem that scholars suggested that the flocks raised on this mountainside here were raised for the sacrifice in the temple unto God. So it was carefully raised. But the ones who are taking care of the flock on this side of the mountain, Jerusalem, is not the best job in the world. As a matter of fact, the profession of a shepherd, my friend, would have been most challenging to many of the religious folks around, to the scribes and the Pharisees who despised shepherds. I'm told of one of the reasons why this job would not have been the best. Imagine going for a job and you know it's not the best job ever. In man's sight, oh my goodness. Oh. The best job ever in man's sight, but in God's sight it is. And here's one of the reasons why it wouldn't have been one of the best job, or they were despised. Because being a shepherd puts one displaces one from the religious activities of his community. And so there would not have been part of those things to be cleansed and when the time comes around, be a part of ceremonial activity. And so many would not have seen that job as a worthwhile, as being the top job. You know, children today, their parents want them to be doctors, my friend. You don't aspire to be a refuse collector. Not a job you aspire to be, but yet the folks understand that the refuse collector has one of the most important jobs in the world. You say, Pastor, why are you saying that? Because, my friend, could you imagine if your refuge is not picked up weekly, what kind of stink you'll have around your house? No matter how much money you have or how educated you are, that stink would carry everyone from you. It would make your things all terrible. Sometimes you look at things in the wrong way sometimes. And I think of these shepherds whom the God of heaven would visit after 400 years. Come to visit them and to make them a part of his plan. And nobody else would want to bring them to their fold. One may ask the question this morning, but why shepherds? Why didn't God call the scribes and the Pharisees who were, when I think of what history tells of the scribes and Pharisees, they were the well-dressed persons. They were the ones walking about with parchments wrapped around them or scriptures placed on their forehead. They were one with long garments and looking very astute, very pious. Why wouldn't God choose those ones? Why would he go to the field and chose the shepherd from the field? Because, my friend, and here is a good yardstick to judge things. Don't judge a man's eyes. God does not see as men see. Let me reverse that. Man does not see as God sees. It'd be wise for you and I, my friend, to ask the Holy Spirit of God to allow us to see as God sees. Because the jobs men choose today and they think is the most prominent in God's eyes, he thinks nothing much of it. God chose these shepherds because God thought much of them. Let me give you this. I think this is very important. the scribes and the Pharisees, even though given the oracles of God, they had the word of God and the writing of Moses and the Old Testament prophets. One may think that that was the position to have. But think of this this morning. The ones that were despised, the shepherds, what were they in control of? Well, the sheep for the sacrifice. Well, they were in control of the example of that which was to come. So while the scribes and Pharisees had the word of God, not really paying attention to it, because if they were, they would have seen and know the time of the coming of the Messiah. Because the scripture clearly lays it out. The shepherds had the oversight of the lamb used for the sacrifice. So they understood that when God sent his lamb, how important it was to recognize it and to see all the things that should be done with the lamb, or should have been done with the lamb of God. And so while in man's eyes the professions were not equal, in God's eyes, the shepherds carried the weight. I thought that was so interesting. Listen to what 1 Corinthians 1:26-29 tells us. Listen how God views things. The Bible reads, "For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called." Men alive. I'm telling you, man. I thank God he chose me, man. When I see these kind of scriptures, when I see the heart of God in this light, I understood why he chose me. That I'm nothing special. I know this morning, if you be honest with yourself and look at yourself, you'll say, "Well, I'm nothing special." But even if you have money, my friend, this morning, to be chosen for a job as this, my friend, that the God of heaven would access you to do his bidding. I'm nothing special, you might want to say. Hear what the Apostle Paul says. Not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things that are mighty, which are mighty. And the base things of the world and things which are despised hath God hath chosen. Yea, and the things which are not, to bring to naught the things that are. No flesh to glory in his presence. Oh, my friend, this morning, he chose the humble shepherds because they were the important ones. They were the ones, my friend, this morning, who he knows can do the job set before them. They will not be seeking to get the glory. They will not be seeking to take his glory. They'll be seeking to glorify him, my friend, this morning, the reason God chose you and I, the nothings of this world, is because, my friend, he wants folks who will glorify him, not steal his glory. Do you hear me this morning? I hope to God, my friend, this morning, that you understand this privileged place, this privileged position that you are placed in. It is to glorify the King of Kings. And God so chose you this morning, my friend, because he knows that you will do the same. He knows that you will be like these shepherds, that you will glorify the King of Kings this morning, not steal his glory. Listen, I don't know why you think about yourself this morning, but maybe you're thinking, boy, nobody likes me. Folks just don't like me. They just hate me. You know, they're I'm not a shepherd right now. You know, I don't look like them. I don't sound like them. I don't have money like them. And I'm folks like that today. You know, if you're not rich and glamorous and, you know, they don't want you around them. That's okay. That's okay. Because when others see a shepherd boy, God sees a king. When others see a woman who is not worth much, oh my goodness, God sees someone, my friend, who blooms into a beautiful rose for him. You know what I'm saying? I say, my friend, this morning, he chose. Thank God he chose me. But look, he chose a humble shepherd also to be a witness. Our text this morning, my friend, you know, I was going to the store again for this morning. It's just amazing that the King of Kings not only came to the shepherds to tell them of this wonderful birth. The King of Kings, my friend, sent his angels to the shepherds, not only to tell them of this wonderful birth, but to give them the most beautiful invite. I love it, my friend. It's the difference. There's a difference. It is something personal when you have someone come into your home or come in your presence. Something personal. I can tell someone, oh, there's something great happening there, but to say, hey, come. Or the shepherds, my friend, they were chosen. They were chosen to come see. Come see this wonderful birth, this baby. The Bible tells us the angel told the shepherd, hey, I bring you good tidings of great joy. Listen to this now to all people. I was bantering this morning with that all the time, my friend, because to me, this entire message is great. Sorry. Even sometimes you can read the scriptures and some parts hit you harder than some. That was hitting me hard this morning. Because I was thinking, this message that the angels brought, I mean, yes, it was for the Jews. I know. But then the angel said, which shall be to all people. All people, small and big. All people, they're educated, they're uneducated. All people, the Jews and the Gentiles. All people. It shall be to all. Don't be afraid. Hey, I know fear and all me is associated when heavenly being visits. But this is something that is not to be fearful of. Shall be to all people. You will find this babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. I was thinking this morning that Shabbat was chosen to go spread this news to all people, not just the righteous, to all, not just sinners, to all people, not just the scholars of the time and the learned ones, all people, not just to one tribe, to all, not just, my friend, the particular sin. Not to Herod or his courtiers who were troubled at it, nor to the greater part of the Jewish nation who, when he came to them, they received him not, but rejected him as the Messiah. Particularly not to the priests and scribes and Pharisees, who when they saw him said, "This is the ear. Let's kill him and seize the inheritance." But to all that were waiting for him, to all that were looking for redemption in Israel, to all, my friend, who rejoiced at his birth, in his salvation, to all, my friend, who will be a part of this new covenant he brings, to all, both Jews and Gentiles, near and far, but what was the message? What was the message that they were going to share for this wonderful news that God hath fulfilled his promise? The Messiah is born. This wonderful news, my friend, that God had fulfilled his promise to send someone, the Messiah of God, who will save his people from their sin, who will save to the uttermost. You know, the Messiah did a lot of things while he was on earth. Boy, he healed the sick. You know, there are many folks this morning who love the fact that he can heal. Talk much about it. Many churches have healing services and all this kind of thing. Oh, he fed the poor when he was here. A lot of folks, my friend, enjoy that fact. Oh, he is able to sustain me physically. A lot of folks even like being around him, his presence. And all those things are good. But the main reason the Son of God was born on this earth is because he came to seek and to save that which was lost. As we study the word Yahash or Yasha, saved, it reveals in several senses in which it is used in connection with God throughout the scriptures. Because God was always in the business of saving. Read in Exodus 14 and 30 that God saved saves Israel, his people. Second Samuel 3:18, from the hand of their enemies. First Samuel 4:3. He promised to save them also from their uncleanness. Ezekiel 36:29. Saves the afflicted ones in Psalm 18:28. He saved those of a contrite heart. Psalm 34:19. He saves the children of the needy. Psalm 72:4. Saves the poor from the sword and the humble. Job 5:22, respectively. He saves not with sword or spear, 1 Samuel 17, but with his right hand, Psalm 138:7. Saves in his mercy, Psalm 31:17. And for the sake of his own name, he saves, Psalms 106:8. He can save directly, 1 Samuel 10:19, or through a human agent, such as King Jeroboam. 2 Kings 14:27. In one instant, the credit is given to the angel of his presence in Isaiah 63:9. In conclusion, God saves. And he's shown it throughout the scripture. Salvation, the salvation of God may come from the outward enemy or inward uncleanness, sins. They may apply to a people or to an individual. So when God the Father sent Jesus Christ, the Son, to the earth, it was to perform the ultimate salvation. One that will save not just outward, but inward and forever. The salvation that the Son of God brought when he came to this earth. For those who will receive him. Word of God tells us in John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have salvation, everlasting life. That they will not have a thirst again. I tell you, my friend, this morning, the message that God so give these angels are of the most importance. God chose them, the weak things of this world, the despised of this world, as he has chosen you and as he's chosen me to carry this powerful message, not only in what we say, but in how we live. But I want to show you right now, my friend, as we close this message this morning, that the angels, they spoke this message to all. The Bible does tell us that, and all that had heard, verse 18 of Luke 2, had heard it, wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. They had some good news to give. But let me share something else with you. Because God did not choose these shepherds clearly here. to put them in great positions or made them be big statues in the sight of men. Changed their occupation, as a matter of fact, when they delivered the message, these men who are now, we can consider them new men, went back to an old job. Oh, can I really speak this to you, my friend, this morning? New men went back to an old job with a new message. It did not change what they were doing. Well, I was a shepherd yesterday, but boy, I saw Christ. And today I'm in the office. No, my friend. Listen what the scripture says. Verse 20 of Luke chapter 2. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, and it was told unto them. New men, because of what they saw, went back to their old jobs with a new way of thinking. What was their new way of thinking? They saw the Christ. Now they have a reason to glorify and praise God. Before they didn't have that. Let me ask you this morning. God have chosen you. What is your message today to those around you? What are you telling folks in the way you're living? They went back glorifying and praising God. Listen, the only way they can do that, my friend, is by changing how they were thinking before. How they were living before. Now, they're glorifying God. Now they're speaking of his praises. I can just imagine how many folks, my friend, how many folks would have been blessed by these men. You see, God didn't change their occupation. He didn't put them someplace different. He wanted them back, right back where they were. Right back where they were. I can tell you of how many folks received Christ as Savior because they saw the difference in their workmate. They were no longer conniving. They were no longer telling lies. They were no longer gossiping because they met the Lord. And they met the Lord and they went back into that same workplace. And the other folks around them saw a difference. And they said, she in the same person, he in the same person, they're different. What's so different about them? Well, they met Christ and they went back into that workplace. Hey, a new person into the same job with a different message. Now they're living for God. Now they're glorifying God with their lives. Everything they do, what they say, the boss becomes more respectful of them, more trusting of them. Why? Because they're no longer doing the old things that they used to do. I ask you this morning, my friend, what are you doing this morning? He has chosen you. Bless God, he has chosen you. He has chosen to talk to you, not some other scholar and elite person, not some other rich and elegant person in the world today. He has talked to you. He has chosen you. Hey, he has given you his message, my friend, to spread and share with the world. He invited you. Come and see Christ. Come and taste and see the Lord is good. And you went and you tasted and you know God is good. I asked you now, how are you living your life? Since he's chosen you. I got to go back in this same old. Listen, hear me. I've talked to too many Christians like this. I go to the same old place. I go tired. Is that glorifying God? You hear me this morning? I know you're tired of the place. Come on now. Talk to God about it. Here's what you tell God. Lord, you know how I feel. God, you've chosen me to declare this wonderful Savior. What a privilege to do it, Lord God. You know how I got to watch these sheep, and I'm tired of watching sheep. I'm tired of the smell, Lord God. I'm tired of the sight. The hour isn't good. Nobody like me. Oh, God, help me. But give me grace, oh God. Give me grace to get over these things. There's some things you must do. You know, I'll tell my wife this. That we are placed in positions sometimes to do the will of God. It's not what we want to do many times, what we have to do. And He called us to do it. It makes no sense shouting on the mountaintop, however much you don't like it. If God have you to be there, trust me, you ain't going nowhere. So what's the best thing to do? Lord, please give me grace. Help me to just get through it. And I'm telling you, man, He is able to give you that grace, to give you the strength in that time when the boss getting on your back. He can put a song in your head, my friend, in your heart, that makes that boss soundless. But you hear him, but it don't get in your nerve because he got the word in your heart. I'm telling you, my friend, God is able to do this. I've seen too many Christians lose this part of their ministry. Lose the effectiveness that they should be by going back where they were before and being a different person. Praising and glorifying God. He's chosen you, my friend. He chose these shepherds. How are you standing right now before Him? I trust as we go through the rest of this Christmas season, and you will see the privileged place you've been put in, the privileged position you've been placed in, whatever. You will give God thanks and do what He's called you to. May God bless you, my friend. Bless God. Thank God for the gift of His Son, that you and I are chosen to declare this good news. May God bless you. I want to see you next week. Same time, same listen here to Solid Word. Okay? Let me bow for a word of prayer for you. 5 o'clock. Sorry. I was going to say that. 5 o'clock. Now, same time, same place. Same place, different time. 5 o'clock. Okay? Thank you so much. Father, thank you this time for the word of God. I thank you for the person, Lord God, right now, listening to this message, who knows, Lord God, that they must be different. Because you've chosen them out of everybody else. You've chosen them. You invited them in, Lord God, personally, to see the Christ, the newborn babe. To spread this message to everyone. And you're telling them, Lord God, they must be different where they are. Just like these shepherds. Like what they were doing. Same place, but a different person. But I pray this morning, even as they ask you right now for grace, you have granted them. You will strengthen them on the inner man. And God, even the outer, will see the glory of God. Men may see God on them, Lord God. Bless them this morning. Thank you again for sending your only Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to die for our sins. He was born. He lived a sinless life. He died on Calvary's cross for our sins. We may have life. There's someone, God, in this midst who does not know Jesus Christ as Savior. And they have known that you, God, sent your only begotten Son to this earth to give man life, to save man. You're always in the same business. But there's the ultimate salvation of all eternity. Lord, may they receive him. For as many as receive him, to them you give the power to become the sons of God, even to those who believe in his name. Thank you for what you do this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friend, send us a text, send us a message. Go to our link below. You can send us a message. I always pray for you. If you made a decision this morning for the Lord, we'll pray for you, pray with you. If you have any questions, we would love to answer them. If we can't, we'll tell you, we'll get back to you. We will get the answer for you, okay? God bless you, friend. See you next week. 5 o'clock service, Christmas morning. God bless you.
Thank you.